Hello, everybody. Welcome. I'm Mark Nathanson. I'm co-chair of the Pacific Council. We thank you all for coming today. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the first ever State of the Global City Address with Mayor Eric Garcetti. We are so excited to hear Eric's vision of LA as a global city, and among other things, to hear what's going on with our exciting Olympic bid for 2024. No one is better to explain our community, where it fits in this ever-changing world of global landscapes, than our dynamic young mayor, who Jane and I have known for so many years and we consider a dear friend. Los Angeles, Southern California, global LA is closely intertwined with the mission and beliefs of the Pacific Council. The Pacific Council works to make Los Angeles a foreign policy powerhouse. Since 1995, our diverse membership is made up of thousands of people who care about the world and events and the challenges that we face on this planet. Whether it's a task force, an investigative trip, a seminar, speaker series, the Pacific Council is the go-to place for foreign policy works for those of us who live and work in Southern California. Before we begin, I want to recognize the RM Liu Foundation. Not only for their generous help in putting this together, but it was their idea that LA should have an annual address by the mayor on the world that is our stage. So I want to thank Bob, Mimi, and Justin. The Pacific Council is so grateful for your continued support. The Liu family, through their contributions to us, to Notre Dame, and to their historic family history in saving Allied troops in Burma during World War II, are all excellent examples of their extraordinary achievements. Let me bring to the podium, to the stage, the third generation of the family's leadership, Justin Liu, to introduce the mayor.
Good evening, everybody. And Mark, thank you very much for that very kind introduction. Thank you for sharing our Notre Dame affiliation in Southern California. That doesn't play too well here sometimes. But I echo Mark's sentiments here in welcoming all of you on behalf of our family and our family's foundation for being here. Really, without all of you guys here, this couldn't be possible. 22 years ago, Mark referenced that the Pacific Council started with a vision from Abe Lowenthal, who's joining us in the back, Bob Abreu, Secretary Christopher, Secretary Bryson, with the idea that international policy couldn't be just heard from the northeast of the US, that the West needed to have its own voice, its own distinct voice as well. That probably couldn't be more prevalent than today. And with the rise and the importance of the political, economic, and social issues today, there is not a city that epitomizes that more than the city of Los Angeles. And within our city, we are extremely blessed to have a mayor that represents the history of the city, the ethnic heritage of the city, who understands the global importance of the city in Mayor Eric Garcetti. I can go through Mayor Garcetti's bio with all of you. Most of you guys know, as you can tell by his popularity, he's like a star here. But probably what a lot of you may or may not know is that Mayor Garcetti was actually very fundamental as an early contributor and participant in the Pacific Council many, many years ago. And so when the Pacific Council first started, his participation, contributions, his rhetoric, and just the tone in which he moderated discussions, participated, was exactly the same as how he tackles things nowadays, which is extremely thoughtful, very charismatic, and with a high level of integrity and credibility. And so his impact to the Pacific Council has been very, very big, and we are here where we are, in large part to people like Eric, and I think it shows the value of a group like the Council and the role that it can play not only for our current leaders of today, but also for our future leaders as well. So our mayor is going to give some opening remarks, and afterwards we're very fortunate to have Pacific Council Board of Director Dr. Cynthia A with us as well too. Dr. A is a professor in the Department of Psychiatry at UCLA, and she is also the director of the, and I hope I get this right, the director of at UCLA's Neuropsychiatric Institute's Spanish-speaking psychosocial clinic. Wow. In addition to her many responsibilities on corporate and foundation boards, she has served the city for 17 years as a city commissioner and currently sits on the board of the Airport Commission. So we thank you for your service to the city, and we thank you for being here tonight. So without further ado, I would like to introduce to you our city's leader and our 42nd mayor, Mayor Eric Garcetti.
Good evening, everybody, and a happy new year. And thank you so much, Justin, for the warmth and friendship that you've provided in my life and the city's work. Your family has been extraordinary, and I'm so grateful for your friendship. And a meeting with Dr. Green that said, we've got this crazy idea. I'm glad I can be an excuse for everybody to see each other tonight. The speech may not live up to the company at your table, but any excuse for Los Angeles to come together, to our consular corps, to our ambassadors who have returned, to those of you who are active in international trade and commerce, this is really an extraordinary room right now. And so I want to thank Bob and Mimi and Justin and Emily. I want to thank, of course, my dear friend Dr. Green, who came to us and said it is time for us to step up. And this is a piece of it. The work that this Pacific Council does to take our rightful place in leadership is what I want to talk to you about here tonight. And I want to talk to you about the way in which Los Angeles can not just be a local and regional and national leader, but a global leader. And I love this opportunity because I don't often get the chance to speak exclusively about global affairs when I traverse the city, country, or even world. It's a never missing part from all of my speeches, but it's never the exclusive topic of my speeches. And so the importance of doing this, hopefully the first of many of these addresses, especially if my job interview with the people of LA goes well next in a month and a half, I will look forward to returning and to seeing the evolution of this great global city. You know, the work that we do right now here in Los Angeles, a collection of either 4 million in the city or 10 million in the county or really 18 million here in this metropolitan region, people. I think that this diverse and innovative place full of people who are constantly reimagining the future have a lot to offer in these very anxious times. And of course, every time the pendulum swings and there is a change of government in Washington, D.C., every time one party takes the reins of power from another, people are wary of the future. They start getting worried that we're headed in the wrong direction. But I think this moment is different. This isn't just about changing ideology today. This isn't about a platform or a policy agenda. I think for many people it feels like the very earth is shifting underneath us, that a bipartisan consensus about institutions and ideology, at least in the foreign relations realm for this country, that the global rules we've always played by, not just because of one election, but maybe a series of them, of events and elections, suddenly is under threat. And coupled with that, the divides feel very deep right now in this world and in this country. The divides between rich and poor, the divides between people of different faiths and nationalities, those of us who live in coastal cities and those who live in the supposed heartland. We've become alienated, at least here in this country, from our fellow Americans, those who we disagree with, to the point that they seem, as President Obama said, that now when we disagree, he said this in his farewell address last week, we now call them not just misguided, but somehow malevolent. And this doesn't just happen here. It would be nice to say this was another example of American exceptionalism. At least it would be nice for the world to hear that. But unfortunately, calls to close off borders, to erect walls, to dissolve our obligations in the global community are increasingly having resonance with all people around the world. It's a time of skepticism. It's a time of pessimism, a time of fear. Happy New Year. But Los Angeles, I think, is best poised in some ways to play a role in changing that. Our city is a haven of tolerance, mutual understanding, a place where we celebrate our differences because we recognize that they are the core foundation of our strength. Our city is investing billions of dollars in infrastructure so we can build new connections to each other and to the world. Our city is taking on its local challenges like poverty and homelessness, the same time that we're reaching for global opportunities like the Olympics. So tonight I want to tell you a little bit of the story of this city, the one that we need to tell to this nation and so desperately need to tell to this world, about why Los Angeles is so important. Because we are at once a place and an idea. There's hardly a citizen of this earth that doesn't have an idea of Los Angeles, that doesn't know us even before they visited us. There was in The Guardian a couple years ago a kind of formula they put together to test the brand strengths of cities around the world, the top 50 cities from Milan to Tokyo to New York, et cetera. The weather, the crime rates, the economic expansion, the social media buzz. And when they put it all into the computer, they were as surprised, you could tell by the tone of the article, of the winner as maybe we were. It was Los Angeles, just above New York, just above London. And I think it's time that we start to recognize that, not in an arrogant way, but maybe we aren't just a global city or a great global city, but one of the most critical and crucial global cities in the world. I hope this story, though, isn't just on how well recognized we are, but that the values that we embody are important values for us here locally, first and foremost, next for our nation, and critically for the world as well. And it's a story here that I wanted to weave in with the idea of the Olympics, because I think the Olympics have always come at a punctuation mark in great moments and great decades, and at times of immense global needs as well. In 1932, when we had the Olympics first, it was a time when nobody else wanted to host them. We had the first Olympic Village, and in the midst of the global depression, we kept the idea of the idealism of the Olympics alive. In 1984, in the midst of the Cold War, when Olympics were not making any money and people wondered whether they would be able to sustain, we not only saved the Olympic movement, we showed that we could turn a profit with a new model. And it was also a time for me as a young boy, I was 13 years old when the Olympics came here, that seared into me the importance of the world connections here in LA. I'm your average Angeleno, right? Or as I said this past summer at the DNC, I'm your average Mexican-American Jewish Italian. And only here in LA could the product of a Jewish mother whose parents and grandparents fled war in the Russian Empire, and a Mexican father whose parents were the product of the Mexican Revolution and crossing borders to come to this place of opportunity, who lived on opposite sides of the track here in Los Angeles, could come together, meeting of all places globally at Pan Am Airlines, get married 6 weeks after their first date, and create a family that was rooted in these global values that have always undergirded who we are and what we are about. This is a city that welcomes people with open arms, no matter what color of their skin, no matter how they worship God, no matter whom they love, no matter their age, their gender, the language that they speak. Los Angeles today is the most diverse city, not just on the face of the earth, but in human history. Let that sink in for a moment. And I think that the Olympic Games to me in 1984 were this moment where my life has been so much about finding LA in the world and finding the world in LA. And I've always said, if you want to see the face of the world, walk the streets of Los Angeles. In a single apartment complex or mini mall, we can find more nationalities than most global alliances. This is a town in which you are once at home anywhere in the world if you grow up here, so that when I did have those opportunities as a young man, to travel, to work, to study in places as far away as Burma or Tokyo, to go places like London or Ethiopia. In those places, I saw the face of Los Angeles on the streets of Addis Ababa and on the streets of Cairo and on the streets of Mexico City. It's one of our pitches with the Olympics is that everybody will have a home field advantage here, because the moment you step off a plane, you find people who eat and talk and communicate the way that you do, but you can be a fourth generation native like myself and see a collision of those cultures that is unlike anything we've seen before. Only here could Twitter and a food truck combine Korean short rib with tacos and suddenly create a craze in how we eat. Los Angeles is constantly rethinking these things. And I grew up in the power of the belief of what those 1984 Olympics were about. That those unforgettable days at the Coliseum and the swim stadium at USC, I became a believer in the power of global cooperation. I never dreamed that 30 years later I might have a role in bringing back an Olympics that coincidentally for my daughter Maya, she will be 13 years old in 2024, to give her the same amazing gift that my parents and that this city was able to give to each one of us when those Olympics came here. And in those moments when I left Los Angeles, whether it was as a high school student traveling to Ethiopia to help on a medical relief mission that seared into me the obligations we have globally, or whether it was as an exchange student in Tokyo and Japan, or whether it was studying abroad and being able to work with the democratic resistance in Burma to help train some of the students and ethnic minorities who had fled to the jungles after the crackdown on them after democratic elections were thrown out. Each one of those moments was a quintessentially Los Angeles moment for me, while it was also a global one. So let me fast forward. The work that I have done and the way that this council has touched my life, the way that Abe Lowenthal gave me a recommendation to go teach at Occidental College when I was a part-timer at USC as a professor of diplomacy and world affairs. When I suddenly decided to run for city council, people said, wait a second, you have this global background in activism. What are you doing running for city council? To which I countered, have you seen the 13th Council District of Los Angeles? Thai town, Little Armenia, historic Filipino town, Little Bangladesh, just to name a few. A place where that diversity that is this city's was in some ways distilled the most. A place where that background had prepared me and those values that my parents had given me and that growing up here gave me quintessentially prepared me for making sure that we could lead locally. Because to do local work here is to do global work. And you cannot succeed locally if you don't have a global understanding. I didn't have to go into Thai town and say, tell me about what Thais are like. I had lived on the border of Thailand and Burma, and my sister had been an exchange student in Chiang Mai University. I had seen, and we could get to work about the common projects and hopes of Americans of Thai descent living in this city. And when we take time, as I have, to carve out of my schedule trips abroad, which I think people think are fun junkets, but if you've ever been on one, I had a bunch of state legislators who are now in the city council. I'm not naming names, but they're like, wow, you work really hard on these local trips abroad. It was different when we did them in the state. We go there because we want to bring that investment, and we want to bring those tourists, and we want to bring that trade. We announced just this past week, or 2 weeks ago, that we had a record-breaking year last year, a record number of visitors to our city, a record amount of cargo at our port, and a record number of passengers at LAX. We blew away previous records. The cargo record held in 2006, we shattered, even in a tough year for global trade and some of the companies involved in that. At the airport, we went past 80 million passengers for the first time. If you've been there lately, you saw it, which is why, and we'll get to that, we're investing $14 billion in bringing, finally, public transportation to LAX to get a lot of those vehicles out there and redo every single terminal. We announced 47.3 million visitors who came to this town. If we didn't take Orange County separately, but we counted them and not double counted them together, we would have more visitors here than anywhere in the United States. These were extraordinary. To have one of those, as we say in the Jewish tradition, Dayenu, to have all three, it was an amazing year. Ask a Jew if you didn't get that joke. But here in Los Angeles, I've also tried to position us not just in those traditional areas, but this is something I want to make sure you hear tonight. We need to also lead on the political stage in terms of this Pacific century. It's why I've engaged our city in global challenges, like the first US-China Climate Leader Summit, which we hosted in 2015, bringing 600 leaders from China and Los Angeles together to do things like announce, that's where we had Guangzhou and Beijing announce that 10 years earlier they would cap their greenhouse gas emissions, the biggest agreement before Paris, right here in Los Angeles, because this is the right place for Chinese and American mayors to meet together. But why is it that we don't host many G8s or G20s? Why is it that it's Chicago or New York or Washington that are always hustling for that, that Seattle seems to be the West Coast stop? Los Angeles is a city we would have to build if one wasn't here. It is arguably the northern capital of Latin America, the western capital of the United States, and the eastern capital of the Pacific Rim. A place that is quintessentially American and global, where 43% of the nation's goods coming through the twin ports of San Pedro Bay, where our airport is now the number one busiest airport in the world of origination and destination. Don't look at the official rankings where we're seventh or eighth. Those ones above us only get higher because of hub traffic, where those people never get off the plane and go into the city. For a mayor, you want to know who actually gets off the plane. We're number one now in the world. So in short, these are all part of the reason I believe in these Olympic Games. We've always been a games changer when we've hosted the Olympics, and I believe that we can be again. I think we need the Olympics because we need a reminder of what it means to engage in the world. We need to be humble as Americans while we are strong. And vice versa, the Olympics need us at a time when we can reboot that amazing global brand, where here we can connect with Hollywood and Silicon Beach and Silicon Valley, that California ethic that says we will find a better way to tell our stories and to communicate and to innovate. Here in a city where we kicked off the space age, we're reinventing it. And how quickly progress comes that we're like, oh, SpaceX landed another rocket perfectly? Boring, you know. This was just 2 months ago that we were wondering whether we could do those things. This is a town where we put the great stories on celluloid that are now on digital medium. We're attracting world investment. This is a town that displaced the New York-London air corridor, which was dominant for 50 years. Last year, Los Angeles to China displaced that as the most important air corridor in the world, and we're not looking back. Los Angeles, it is time to lead. And when we see the opportunities that the Olympics give us, in a town where 77% of the people support the Olympics, I mean, you can't get a 77% vote for anything, and yet here in Los Angeles, people remember that and see the importance of it. Here in a town where we've raised $40 million in private donations, thanks to people that are in this room as well, to put that bid together, now is the time to win that. And I think that as we make that bid, we can show them what sustainability in economic and environmental terms really is about. In fact, we have everything built for the Olympics except a single facility for whitewater canoeing, which will be a hit and people want to visit afterwards. And those facilities are not old ones. Sure, we have great legacy places like the Coliseum that we will use and benefit from a USC $200 million investment, an additional $100 million to turn the track back into an Olympic track. But we have the Staples Center. We have all these, you know, the StubHub Center, all these places that have been built since the 1984 Olympics, the most expensive stadium that will ever be built in the world, not ever, that has been built to date, I'm sure we'll pass it, with the Rams Stadium in Inglewood, is extraordinary. It's not built on the public dime. And instead of the mistake of building a lot of infrastructure for the Olympics that may or may not serve the people of that city, we're building infrastructure for that city that the Olympics will benefit from, so that we're investing in 16 new rail lines thanks to the great voters who passed Measure M, and 465,000 jobs that will come from that. That's good for us first, but the Olympics can benefit. That's the model we need. All of what I'm describing is part of this extraordinary moment for Los Angeles. Those record numbers that I mentioned of visitors, those record numbers that I mentioned of cargo and of passengers, they're mirrored in the most fundamental statistics I can give you. As CEO of the city, if it was my business, you know, selling widgets, widgets for me is people. And people can move wherever they want, jobs can go wherever they're best, people can study, you know, if they're coming to universities wherever they want, and they can certainly visit on their vacations wherever they want. And more people, for the first time, you couldn't say this 2 years ago in Los Angeles, live, work, study, and visit Los Angeles than ever before in our history. This is a moment for our city. And the investments that we're making, whether it's the $120 billion in Measure M, or the 10,000 units of affordable housing we will build for people who are on our streets tonight as I speak, show that we don't just reach for opportunities, we address the most pressing challenges that cities around the world, and certainly this country, are facing. As people come back to cities, there are those who are losing. We have to make sure we don't just attract great jobs, but we grow them up right here. So that the tripling of youth jobs, for instance, in the summer from 5 to 15,000 is one of the things I'm most proud of, because I want the next Mark Zuckerberg to be an African-American girl growing up in South LA, or a Latino boy who's in Pacoima or in Boyle Heights. We can connect that greatness with opportunity as well. Let me conclude, and I know we have a bit of a discussion to have as well, but I think we have to look at this century. I remember when Abe and I wrote actually something right around the same time about this being a Pacific century. It's real. This really is a Pacific century. And if you look at those people who are coming here and the focus that we've spent on the Pacific Rim from Latin America to East Asia to Oceania and our continuing ties to Europe and to Africa, Los Angeles needs to assert itself. Now we have ambassadors, Mamet and Hachigi and Emerson who have just returned. You can't shake a stick without hitting a former ambassador in here, and that's a wonderful, I think, acknowledgement of what sort of leadership this town has produced. But since Warren Christopher was our Secretary of State, we haven't had a Pacific perspective leading in state. At this moment, we need it as a nation. This isn't just boosterism for Los Angeles. We need to make sure that we have that sort of perspective in our defense work, in our diplomatic work, in the highest stretches, in the highest regions of our government. It should be a goal of ours not just to host, but to place and to make sure that our Pacific century is led by those who have a Pacific perspective. Our nation, no question right now, is feeling insecure. Huge shifts are underway. We know right now that this is a tough moment. But what we did in 1932, what we did in 1984, what I know we can do again in 2024 is to fundamentally return to who we are and what we're about. This time as a great, forward-looking city, a place where the world turns to us for inspiration, for new ideas and strong leadership, that's what we need today more than ever. As we find ourselves taking on global fights at our own doorsteps, I think if I can just go back to the personal and end there, these aren't just values that my city needs for economic prosperity. These aren't just values that are good for our competitiveness. These are values that are personal for all of us. When I look at Syrian refugees, how can I not think about Jews that were turned away from our shores? Or Britain, where the first time the term illegal immigrant was ever used was in World War II, when Jews were trying to escape the Holocaust. When I look at unaccompanied minors who turn themselves into border agents, looking for their mothers or fathers here in this land, how can I not think of my grandfather who lost his father in the Mexican Revolution and was carried over the border as a one-year-old by my bisabuela, my great-grandmother? How can we not see our connection and our destiny to the things we do? How can I not see my daughter sitting there at the stadium in 2024? And I think as we bring who we are to this fight and to this world today, we know that the local is global, and the global is local here in Los Angeles. Los Angeles, it is time for us to lead. It is time for us to build the institutions and values that we are, of life, of love, of prosperity and leadership. This is our century. Let us lead it. Thank you.
Wow. Fantastic. And on behalf of everyone here, we again want to extend the warmest welcome. We are so excited to have you here, Eric. And I can't really overstate how very proud we are as Angelenos to have a mayor that represents us so well on the international stage and who really has a deep appreciation for the critical importance and the complexity of international relations and their impact on trade, on the economy, on jobs. And also, very importantly, something you've really begun to do is to, in your vision, to position Los Angeles as not just a global leader, but as a role model in terms of our values with respect to immigration, to diversity, to climate change, and on and on. Mm-hmm. So thank you Absolutely. So much, Eric.
Thank you.
And on to some of our first questions here. So you have talked a lot about kind of your overall vision about LA as a global city. What can we look forward to in 2017? What's on the horizon in terms of your kind of more specific initiatives to really position us again as a global city in general? You've already done a great job, I'll say, in utilizing the Los Angeles World Airports and the port as very important platforms.
Because
really
of my commissioners,
Right, a great word. Exactly. And in fact, I wanted to mention, brilliant, and appointing an ambassador to head up the Harbor Commission, Bill
Martinez,
who's somewhere here.
Right there. We've got two Argentinian ambassadors, the U.S. ambassadors to Argentina.
Exactly. But in any event.
Yes. Well, 2017, I think the big global issue is us landing the Olympics. The vote will be in September in Lima, Peru.
Yeah.
And we've got two superb cities we're competing with, Paris and Budapest, all of which would have amazing Olympics. I think that, you know, we have a different bid than the other places, and each one of them has a different strength, but it is a time for all of us to utilize any connections to those 98 voters who will be voting to convince them to come to LA. It's like a high school election, right, for class presidents. That's small if you think about the voting school. Second, I think it's very important for us. I launched an export initiative. And you know, today when TPP, through an executive order, was withdrawn from, I think there's a lesson there. And I assume most of this room was probably pro-TPP, but maybe there's some people who won't. But let me step back from it. I think we put such an onus on whether TPP was going to be passed that here in Los Angeles, we're actually both sides of globalism, globalization. You know, I don't believe in this coastal versus heartland idea, because when manufacturing jobs were lost in Youngstown, more were lost in Los Angeles. Remember, we had car factories. We had middle-class jobs putting together aerospace here. We actually felt that as much as anywhere. So we're not different. We're not mostly space executives and Hollywood stars, though we love them. We're mostly everyday people who work as bus drivers or manufacturing. It's the manufacturing capital of America. So I think instead of getting caught up on TPP, which was more in some ways about those who are already doing well being able to expand their businesses, but look at, for instance, why in this global city only 1% of our business is export. 1%. In a town where 63% of our population are immigrants or children of immigrants. In a town where 61% of our main street businesses are started by immigrants.
Amazing.
So we're putting a strong push. We're cold calling, you know, 500 companies a week out of City Hall to see if we can just double that number. I mean, 2% doesn't sound like a great number, but trust me, that's a lot more jobs, a lot more prosperity, and we can compete and win globally. One last thing I'll say on that, like Tigum. Anybody ever heard of the company Tigum? Have you ever been to the Grove and been on the trolley?
Yeah.
That's manufactured by Tigum.
Ah.
The best of our cities. It was ex-Hollywood props guys together with some clean energy folks, and here in Chatsworth, in the city of Los Angeles, they manufacture first this beautiful, you know, trolley cars. Then they started competing globally. The city of LA helped write a letter to get the Export-Import Bank backing for them, and they competed against the big boys, Siemens and others who dominate that, and they won in Aruba. They won in UAE to build out you know, their entire streetcar systems. Yeah. So we can do these things, we just need to connect more businesses with that. So I think that's the second real big thing this year we'll be pushing for.
That's fantastic, that's great. So, as I'm sure you know, and you alluded to that, there is a deep concern at home and abroad about the kind of president's inaugural address and also earlier remarks. And earlier remarks with respect to international policy.
Sure.
And kind of signaling a retrenchment from American values of leadership in the world, and also kind of a retreat from international cooperation, and really kind of it seemed to me a lack of understanding of the delicate nature of diplomacy and its impact on trade, on economy, on jobs and such. So what will the implications be for a place like Los Angeles, which is positioning itself as a global leader, number one, and how do we distinguish ourselves as a region that is still very much embracing diversity, very much extending our hand to our neighbors to the south, very much welcoming persons from around the world to be part of our economy?
Well, I think there's two questions in there. One of them is, you know, to what degree will we actually believe in institutions? And if we do still believe in institutions, what will they look like? Mm-hmm. There's no question this isn't just about our new president or new administration. Throughout the world, you know, I remember when I took international law with a professor named Lewis Henkin. Some of you may have heard of him. He kind of was one of the writers of international law. And I remember him well into his 80s teaching class, and he said, international law exists because we say it does. And to a 22-year-old, I was like, my head was spinning. I'm like, what do you mean? Is it real or is it not? Does it actually exist or not? And you realize it existed when everybody agreed that it existed. But the moment people agree it doesn't, that institution, that thing we think is so solid, begins to erode. There can be a decision on the South China Sea in an international court, but if a country decides to ignore it, it doesn't have any power. And I think that there's a domestic lesson there too, which is that we believe in our institutions so much, and they are stronger than most places, but they're still human. They exist only until they don't exist. And so, first and foremost, the question, not just for the administration, but for this world, is, are we going to believe in institutions? And what role will we play in backing them up? It's fine to renegotiate trade agreements, but will we believe in trade agreements at all? Or will we move more towards chaos and towards no rules or whatever you can get away with? Will we build and join institutions? For instance, as China builds a new kind of competitor to or replacement of the World Bank, we were the only country that didn't sign on to it. We should have, I think. And the Treasury Department convinced others not to, and I think even people inside the administration realized it was a mistake because suddenly it was an affront to Chinese who were really building for the first time a really globally engaged institution. And you can always build a conspiracy theory around it, but I'm sure most of the world did when we built the World Bank and the IMF. And so it's really important for us to get to the heart of whether we believe in institutions, first of all, and if we do, okay, it's all right to renegotiate them, but we have to try to have that discussion together about what the values of those will be. The last part is, what are our values at all, and what role can Los Angeles play in that? I think Los Angeles can be the embodiment of those values. We may have an executive action on immigration in the coming weeks, but so far that there wasn't in the first few days an action, for instance, on Dreamers, I think has been because we have all articulated the values of the importance of the contributions of these young people, most of whom are in school, all of whom got an, on average, 40% boost in their wages. That drives up native wages because nobody's working under the table. I just did a joint resolution with Republican and Democratic mayors that I wrote at the US Conference of Mayors last week, and we had Republican mayors standing up. Two of the three senators who introduced legislation to protect the Dreamers are Republicans, not Democrats. Right. There's Dick Durbin, but then Senator Flake and Senator Graham. So I think if we stand up for the values, it pushes the question. So now you have President Trump saying, oh, we're going to do something good for the Dreamers. We have to make sure that he does. I want to work with him to make sure that that occurs. But if we can articulate our values strongly, I do believe we can make sure that not just institutions, but you know, the things that we stand for are defended and protected.
Great, fantastic. So, a potentially controversial issue here. What would be the ramifications of the threatened potential sanctions against sanctuary cities, and what implications will that have for Los Angeles, and how do we, what is the path forward? What is the strategy?
Well, I feel well protected. Los Angeles isn't a sanctuary city. We've never declared ourselves to be one, and there's a perversion of the term. For those of you who know your Central American history, it really was a very specific thing in the 1980s that referred to folks that couldn't get in here because they were refugees from the wrong country. If you're from Nicaragua fleeing, you could get in the Reagan administration. If you're Salvadoran, you couldn't. So there were cities that said, we will create sanctuaries in our churches. Even some cities like San Francisco said, we are a sanctuary city. That we don't care what country, if you're a refugee and you're facing war, we should not play politics with it. It then has been used and kind of claimed by folks, anybody who wants to criticize immigration policies they don't like. Here in Los Angeles, if you turn on Fox News, we're definitely a sanctuary city, even though we never declared ourselves a sanctuary city, because before even the civil wars of Central America in the late 70s, that very progressive police chief named Daryl Gates decided that it was very important for us to make sure our local law enforcement officials, even he recognized, had the trust of the people that they police. And in our diverse immigrant communities, we wanted to make sure that people were witnesses to crime, felt good about cops, didn't think they were going to be stopped on the street for the way they looked. And most cities have the same. But there are a lot of myths around sanctuary cities. For instance, the idea that we don't cooperate with federal law enforcement officials, patently false. We do all the time. We hand over dangerous rapists and murderers and other people to federal officials. We just have a procedure for that, and it demands a warrant from a court, not, oh, that person looks the wrong way. And so we feel very strongly about that, and I feel very well protected. And I'll tell you why. The 10th Amendment, I believe, protects us from mandates that we have to change how we do that business in exchange for funding. Where does this come from in the latest challenge? Ironically, from the Affordable Care Act. And it was Chief Justice Roberts who said when the Obama administration was trying to force states to expand Medicaid as part of the conditions of taking ACA, they successfully defended against that and said, we don't want to expand Medicaid. Well, ironically, with different politics, that will now come back to either haunt them or be a bulwark and a defense for us, which is that I think the Supreme Court has spoken very loudly. You cannot force cities or states to do something in exchange for funding, unless it's about that specific program. Mm-hmm. So we receive $500 million in federal funds, but none of that is for cooperation between LAPD and federal immigration officials. Mm-hmm. That would be, I think, the only constitutional thing they could take away. They may try to, but I think we're going to have a very strong court case. But that aside, I hope we don't have to fight in court. Mm-hmm. And I want to say this very loud and clear. It is my responsibility to engage, and I actually look forward on many aspects and where we can find common ground to engage with this administration. Mm-hmm. I think that is my responsibility as your mayor. Mm-hmm. On infrastructure, if they want to spend $1 trillion, awesome.
Right.
Start right here with $120 billion down payment and match the money that we're taxing ourselves to do, and we'll get you to that $1 trillion. You want to work together on good trade expansion? Great. We'll figure out a way to do those things together. The president has been wonderful on the Olympics. I called him, and he brought it up the first thing. He said he wanted to help, and for the first time in years, we had the President of the United States and the President of the International Olympic Committee on the phone.
Right.
He called me back to tell me about it afterwards. So we all have to find common ground. This isn't about attacking one person. This is about standing up for the values of who we are, not pointing out and yelling. It's what we do, not what we say.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. Okay. So we're seeing a rising tide of nationalism, you know, at home and abroad. What will the implications be for Los Angeles that positions itself as a global leader? And then how do we reach out and educate, you know, the American people about the implications of this? And how do we then kind of model that in Los Angeles? Because of the, you know, there's this really growing, you know, rhetoric about the evils of international policy and trade and such.
You know, I think we are too connected for that to have the same resonance it once could. American nationalism has always been distinct from some other nationalisms because it's not an ethnic-based nationalism. It's a civic nationalism. Mm-hmm. We don't all share a common, you know, hundreds of year old history. We come from every corner of the earth. Some of us have been here for thousands of years. Others came here of their own will or their ancestors did. Others came unwillingly as slaves. We have, you know, a civic nationalism that has always, I think, been rooted in a different kind of foundation than almost any other country. That said, I think it's very difficult to turn inward. I think we're well past that point. I mean, just think about how we buy things or how we communicate. We don't use the term multinational corporation anymore because any big corporation is multinational.
It's multinational.
You know, those things that used to be unique now are the default. And I think the closeness and connections that somebody on your Facebook page may be commenting from, you know, Comoros or from Ghana, you know, that is compressed. I remember when I, on Instagram, I'm on Instagram, I try to just use it as an escape from my photography, but on Instagram they highlighted me one weekend and I thought somebody had hacked my account because I went from like 10,000 followers to 80,000 followers. But they said, no, that just happens when we highlight and suddenly people join. And I suddenly had all these followers in Abu Dhabi and I had all these followers in Indonesia and all these followers, and suddenly I was like, why do these people want to follow the mayor of Los Angeles? But they are now in LA, and I show them LA every single day. So I think our nationalism may be aspirational more than achievable if it's inward focused. And I think Los Angeles is the reminder of that. What does America First mean anymore? I think we can see nationalism that withdraws from some institutions, and that will be damaging. But at the end of the day, we're too global to stop. And in Los Angeles, I'll end my answer with this. Think about how far we've come in just 20 years. Remember those articles after the riots where our diversity was going to rip our city apart?
Mm-hmm.
You know, right. Time magazine cover, people wondering could Koreans get together, you know, get along with African Americans and Latinos. When I was in Seoul, Korea, the mayor of Seoul said to me in a private conversation we had, he said, how do we get to be more like you? I said, what do you mean? He said, more like your city's diversity. We're doing exceptionally well. We're innovating. We're hardworking. We have great companies. But we realize if we don't have more cultures and more diversity like LA, we'll never compete and succeed. And I said, wow. In the space of just two decades, what was seen as our greatest fault line suddenly was looked to as an example and our greatest strength.
Fantastic. So, and last question, and we'll open it up to the audience. On a positive note, Public diplomacy has always done wonders to enhance international relations and goodwill. As Jeff Cowan, who I think I saw here, will attest to.
I see his handsome face right there.
Exactly. And Hollywood certainly has played, you know, the key role in positioning LA as the global leader mm-hmm. in entertainment. But now it seems that LA is emerging as a leader in the arts world, particularly contemporary art, with not just the museum we've had for a while, mm-hmm. whether it's LACMA and Getty, but even with your recent success in terms of George Lucas Museum, the Broad Museum, et cetera. So how can we position LA as really a global art center?
Well, I think we have it. We just have to be, we have to say it even more. I mean, mm-hmm. think about this year, the second Pacific Standard Time, which is a convening that the Getty Foundation does to bring together all the arts institutions. Mm-hmm. And this year it's called LALA, will be Latin mm-hmm. American and Latino artists. So we'll focus on both the diversity of Latino artists here and also our ties to Latin America. Other countries like Mexico is tying on the Year of Mexico here in Los Angeles to it, which is going to be a wonderful kind of display of our ties and our culture here. I think we just have to my earlier point, be a little less insecure. Like this is the arts capital, contemporary arts capital of the world. Yes. Just accept it, it's okay. You know, it feels good. And I'm not just saying this is a booster. It's an exceptional place. Why are so many new institutions, the Getty, the Broad, the Berggruen Institute, the latest, of course, with what I think will be an exceptional museum, despite what one art critic said, with the Lucas Museum. I mean, they're coming to LA because A, we can get things done, B, this is where the excitement is, and if they want to reach the world, they can just do that with the population that's here, let alone who will come here. This is an easy place to come to. The fanboys and fangirls who will come to see, you know, Star Wars stuff at the Lucas Museum will come and go next door to the African American Museum, or as George Lucas said, they'll see how we imagine going into space and then go to the other end of Expo Park and see how we actually got there with the space shuttle. You know, this is a place that captures one's imagination. If I could say one thing, we should deepen our Pacific art ties, though. Mm-hmm. You know, we have an amazing collection of oceanic art at LACMA. We need to embrace that and talk about that more. We have an amazing, collection of Asian art, the Latin American art. We need more exchanges. We've talked to museums in Mexico and, mm-hmm. Noah and I were talking about the book fair that's in Argentina and ones that are in Guadalajara. We just need to do more of that and talk about it more. But we are the contemporary arts capital of the world.
Yay.
So enjoy it while it lasts, at least.
Great. I'd like to open it up now to the audience for any questions you may have. I see right there.
Right here.
Raise your hand. Yes, right there.
And though I know who you are, Carol, why don't you say who you are to everybody?
Carol Hamilton. So speaking of art, I just got something from Alliance Française today that said that we are the contemporary arts capital of the world, and they're doing a French art thing in a month or so.
That's great.
But my question is, you mentioned that you want to try to find areas of common agreement, if that would be the word, with the new administration. And I'm just wondering, other than the Olympics, what those areas might be.
Sure. So I think first and foremost is infrastructure. We have about $800 billion of badly needed infrastructure repairs in this country. One other estimate is $3.2 trillion of extra work just to get up to a passing grade for our bridges, our rail, our transit. When I talked to the president, he's somebody who grew up in New York. He actually got subways. Oftentimes, unfortunately, one party is more pro-transit and the other one is like, no, we're just about highways and roads and transit is just for democratic cities and we don't need to invest in things like subways and rail lines. I think that we just had a meeting. I convened Gary Cohn, who is going to be the head of the National Economic Council and probably the most important economic actor in the Trump administration, who's the CEO, outgoing CEO of Goldman Sachs. Kathleen, he says hi. and I brought six mayors together, bipartisan mayors, who have all passed local measures like we did here in Los Angeles, and sat down to talk about how we could shape the infrastructure package that they'll put forward. I think we need a national infrastructure bank. And Steve Mnuchin, who comes from Los Angeles, has talked about that. So I think infrastructure, first and foremost, is going to be a very ripe area. The Olympics is a very particular one to LA. I think we've got really strong support, and I thank the president for that. He's been wonderful. It's, in his wheelhouse. He's even, give me more people to call. He's been really good about that. I hope, and you may be surprised for me to say this, I hope immigration. And I'll tell you why. If it's just, and look, as a Mexican-American, Jewish-Italian guy, I was as offended by what was said as anybody. I'm never going to not say that. But it's also was important when I spoke to him to say, I don't know if people are talking about this, but I want you to hear the economic impact. This town is booming. Please don't set us backwards. Mm-hmm. Your average Trump voter doesn't want to see people working for less than minimum wage under the table. We all have a stake in making sure our dreamers can continue to go to college, get good jobs, et cetera. So when I look for areas of common ground, it's not that I don't write anybody off. I'm not naive, but I don't write anybody off. I also think that there will be areas that we can work on together in energy, despite the different approach we take maybe on global warming and climate change. I do think that there are going to be opportunities to upgrade our electrical grid, to increase the efficiency of even our renewables, which is now not just driven by environmentalists, it's driven by business and people who are in the business of renewable energy. Just ask Daniel Weiss up there. And I think another area, a last area that I hope that we can find some collaboration on as well, is in the area of regulation. I do actually, now having been in government for 16 years, want to see plenty of regulations. Each well-intentioned stone we have put into the backpack has led to a really heavy backpack. Now, I'm not talking about getting rid of clean air or clean water or the regulations we need, but there are so many things that are so inefficient about how we spend our money. Just think about the stimulus package, even from my dear friend in this last administration. It was necessary, but as a city, it went to the state first, so the federal government could say we had spent it, and the state doled it down to the city, then there's 15 regulations. It took us like 3 or 4 years to spend money that should have been out on the street in 2 or 3 months. So I hope that's another area that we can work on together, and they can listen to what it's like on the receiving end of federal funds and give us more freedom, both for defensive and offensive reasons. Suddenly a bunch of us are saying we're like these states' rights people. You know, give us the money,
yes.
Trust us, and let us run with it. In California, I think we'll do well.
Okay, I see a gentleman there in the back.
Is that Abe Lowenthal?
At that last, yes, is that Abe? I can't
he see. He has it. Founder's the prerogative.
It lights in my eyes here. Yes, it is Abe.
First of all, thank you so much for an inspiring talk.
Thank you.
In the prehistory of the Pacific Council, the idea or the activities that eventually led some of us to put this organization together was a California-Mexico project that was based on the concept that if California were an independent country, its foreign policy priority would be the relationship with Mexico.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And Mexico's foreign policy priority would be the relationship with California. That led to a number of people interacting with each other and eventually led to the Pacific Council, which rightly covers the whole world and has a particular Pacific perspective. Today, in today's circumstances, the importance that Mexico has for California and California has for Mexico is all the greater than it was when we were talking about those issues. And the possibility that the national capitals, or at least our national capital, can deeply damage mm-hmm. a relationship that gains a great deal on both sides from the interaction that is embodied in our city and in Southern California generally, is really probably the single thing that worries me mm-hmm. the most in my small slant at the universe. We really are in a position where we could do great damage to Mexico, and that damage will be felt first here. Is there some way, I know Michael Camunis has been working up a Mexico initiative with the Pacific Council, mm-hmm. which I think is a splendid idea. Are there people in your shop that could help make sure that this council really makes a major contribution to thinking through how we can avoid disaster in the relationship with Mexico?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. My first trade mission I took was to Mexico. It was to underscore that importance. Oftentimes everybody was going off to our dear friends in Japan and China and Korea, and that was my second trip. But I wanted to make sure that people understood that you start local and you go out from there. And in some ways, Mexico is local to us. We have a shared history. We have much shared culture. You could argue we have a shared language. We have all sorts of things that tie us so intimately. Our number one source of visitors is from Mexico. It's such a critical trading partner. And And yet there had been, long before there was talk of building a wall, there had been kind of artificial walls that had popped up between us. Think about just, again, 20 years ago, when Prop 187 was before us and what Mexicans thought of Californians and what we passed. There's been a sea change since then, and there's a comfort level, and there's an intimacy. And I don't want to make the rest of the consular corps jealous, but the consul general from Mexico is always almost part of my team and vice versa. And it's not just about the national government anymore. You have governors of the states in Mexico opening up offices here. Mexico provides leadership for a lot of Latin America, especially in these times. To if you're Guatemalan or Salvadoran and you show up at the consulate, they're going to help you in these times to navigate getting legal help and the city's justice fund that we've set up to give people due process should there be mass deportation. So we're a little bit on defense for the next few months just to make sure that we can protect who's here. And the importance of me of, some people said, how can we be spending money defending illegal immigrants is kind of the critical line. I said, we're spending money to ensure that there's due process and there's an 8 times mm-hmm. more likely good outcome of your legal proceeding in front of a judge if you have counsel than if you don't. And so we're focused very much on that. But yes, I have opened up the Office of Immigrant Affairs for the first time in Los Angeles. Dr. Linda Lopez, a former dean at USC Leeds, she's an important part of that relationship. My international trade office is an important part of that. And also I've asked our tourism officials to continue promoting tourism both directions. Finally, I do think that the number of Mexican American, and not just them, but immigrant businesses in general, but Mexican American businesses aren't doing much exporting, and I do want them to be a key part of that initiative. I think people think of NAFTA or international trade as only going one direction, and we have all these caricatures of it. There's aerospace happening in Mexico to supply plane assemblers here. Similarly, I went down to Mexico and Panda Express, our friend Andrew Chung was opening up over 100 restaurants, and I helped him do that. And everybody would have figured, orange chicken could conquer the world. It probably can. And that food is manufactured here in Rosemead and exported to Mexico. We don't think of that trade as being like, well, we're creating food jobs to send food to Mexico as a result. So trade is a good. We have to be careful and make sure it's the right kinds of trade. But I think absolutely we're poised to. We look forward after we get through, hopefully, the defense of the next few months, looking at what we can do to embody that friendship and the depth of that relationship.
Right. Well, I'm being given the hook here by my friend Jerry.
Do you need to cut it off? I can take another one.
You can take another question?
I can take a couple
more.
Okay,
great, fantastic.
I already read my daughter's story. She's not coming home by bedtime,
so
I can take a couple more.
Someone over here? Oh, there you go, sure.
Thank you, yeah, absolutely.
But I am laughing very hard, believe me. But here's the question. When you get to host the Olympics, athletes from all over the world will be gathering here. Yeah. Here it is legal to consume marijuana, but Olympians are supposed to be very stoic, so is this even an issue, considering a bit?
I love that our consul general can't get approval to wish us luck, but he can ask a question about marijuana. I want that posting. I want that posting. No, I mean, it does give the high jump a whole new meaning. But we are really excited. Think about it for a moment. The next Olympics that we have are going to be in South Korea, then in Japan, and then in China. Wouldn't it be perfect to have 4 Pacific Olympics in a row between the 2 winter games and the 2 summer games right here sharing this one ocean? So I'm really excited for you. I'll do a little bit of research and get back to you on that question. But yeah, I hope the consular corps has no such restrictions themselves.
Okay, I see someone here. Okay. There, there's a...
In the far back over there?
There. There you go. Okay.
Oh, yes, it's working. You spoke about that it's about standing up for our values, right? Don't you think LA should take a more active role, more than defensive? My question is about what can Mexican Americans do? What would you suggest we do sort of pressure the Trump administration if he decided to charge the 35% on remesas to Mexico? What could LA do if we wanted to take a more active stance, specifically Mexican?
On that issue, I don't know that Los Angeles, I mean, we could raise our voices and say how terrible this is for our economy. I think we have to humanize these stories. So whether it's of a dreamer, or for instance, everybody's so fixated on the dreamers, and they're great, and that's very important and very sympathetic, that I've been promoting, for instance, the 50,000 undocumented parents of military personnel who were given temporary status. I mean, these are parents who literally, their children may come home from serving this nation, and they might be gone, or worse yet, they might be in proceedings and their children not come home from war. That seems fundamentally un-American, especially as the grandson of a dreamer who earned his citizenship by volunteering in World War II. And I'm literally here because my grandfather Salvador did that. I think it's humanizing those stories. We may not always have formal power, and I don't want you to hear that we're only playing defense. I meant legal defense. But we are absolutely going to be on offense. Whether it was in the Obama administration, we were defending DACA and deferred action and other initiatives. I brought together for an amicus brief the cities of the country who sometimes, the population we put together was more than the states that were challenging the Obama administration. But that playbook's out there. Javier Becerra tomorrow will officially become the Attorney General of the state. He's one of the most knowledgeable people in this country on immigration, and he's going to be our lawyer in this state. Eric Holder has been retained by the legislature to advise the former Attorney General. I mean, we've got plenty of weapons to challenge on the actions and then the individual defense. I mean, think about this. If we provide counsel to just a few more people, if deportation hearings ramp up, the immigration courts barely function today. I mean, they're so slow, right? That if we had, you know, 1,000 more cases with 1,000 lawyers, it will grind to a halt, unless there's four times as many judges tomorrow, which I haven't heard as part of the program. So I think that we have a lot of different options. Again, I don't say those things lightly. I don't say those things to challenge, and I don't say those things to personally, you know, disrespect an office that I have a ton of respect for in the presidency. I think it's just important for us to know that if we put those things out there, we all know, I think, as Americans, where we want to go. This isn't a Democratic issue. A majority of Republicans and Democrats want comprehensive immigration reform. And when the president told me when he was president-elect, it's a broken thing that he wants to fix and do something big, great. Let's get to work on that. I will be your partner on that. Don't put us in, it'll slow down any administration, if I were giving the president counsel, any administration sets out its big goals and thinks they can accomplish them right away because they've been elected. And really, it only takes one or two things to slow you down quickly to a halt. Let's figure out the things we all agree on. Infrastructure, comprehensive immigration reform, figuring out a way to be energy independent. And that's not just by ignoring global climate change, but actually embracing it. And let's use those things to be on offense together and not just to play defense. I don't know that we have any power if they put that sort of a tariff on transfers or on, you know, even the goods movements. But I think we can tell what the human impact is. We can show the unemployed. We can look at the misery on our streets, and not just of immigrants who lose those jobs, but what it means to the business community here. And I think that will have resonance with this administration.
Great. One last question? Okay, right there. He's been raising his hand over and over again, so we'll take you as the last question.
Thank you. Despite my name, Christian Wright. I needed some time to recover on Thursday, but Saturday was really inspirational, as I think a lot of people in this room would agree. And I just want to thank you for being mayor, for your leadership, and also for encouraging all of us to lead as well in our own abilities. My question to you is, I know you're busy, you are mayor, but if you weren't mayor, in other words, if you were one of us here in this room or one of the many Angelinos outside of this room, where would you be spending your energies? What organizations might you want to get involved with? Yep. What movements might you want to launch if kind of in a best effort to, pardon the phrase, effect positive change?
So I said before, this is the arts capital of the world. It's my aspiration to make this kind of the activism capital of the world, too. And we're not there yet. We're not there yet, but we need to be. And when you think about that, crosses party lines, too. I mean, think about it. The, you know, whether it was 400,000, whether 750,000, we had probably the largest march in our history this weekend, or close to. It wasn't really a march, right? It was so crowded, it was just like a stay where you are. Don't move. Circle around. Okay. And a lot of people, you know, what I said there that I'll paraphrase, I said, it's not what we say that'll be important, it's ultimately what we do. That moment was important for us to hear each other's voices, but it's what we do. If we believe in women's rights, let's stay on that one because I could go in 12 different directions, but if we believe in women's rights, you know, the next day, you know, we should be out there the next workday, tomorrow you can do it, should be volunteering for donating to the Downtown Women's Center, where a survivor of domestic violence who's living on the street tonight needs help to get off the street and to no longer be homeless and to heal. If we believe in human rights for women, we should get involved with CAS, the Coalition to Abolish Slavery and Trafficking, mm-hmm. Which helps people who have been globally trafficked, and locally the 13 and 14-year-old girls who are on Vermont Avenue tonight and are in the San Fernando Valley are being trafficked here in the city and even being exported from Los Angeles to other places where we found them. If you care about women's rights, let's find a way that you as a lawyer can volunteer and be part of our justice fund or donate to it so that an immigrant girl or woman can have legal defense and due process should she face deportation hearings. If you believe in women's rights, get involved as Ambassador Frank Baxter is and other people in education and building great schools and making sure that people have opportunities to make a difference or to make community college free like we're doing in this city. If you believe in women's rights, be a woman who runs for your neighborhood council or shows up to a meeting and testifies to say homeless housing should be built in my city so that not just the people who don't want it show up, or run for office or ask to serve on a commission. When Justin Trudeau became prime minister, I loved his answer when they said, why is half of your cabinet women? And he just said, because it's 2016. And we have for the first time, I thank some really good men who have served for commissioners many times for years. And for the first time in LA city history, more than half of our city commissioners are women because we just made it happen. So I think get engaged, get involved, run, do things. Don't just talk about it. Get off of your Facebook wall and get out into the streets, not to the protests in the streets. I think that is part of our democratic right. But if we're just out there, whether it's on the streets or on Facebook yelling, again, that's not going to accomplish much. And I'll end with this, because I also think, and you maybe have heard this, I think our obligation to engage doesn't mean sacrificing our values. I think we've overplayed that this is the change of this administration is all about one person. You know, in a friend of a few of ours, Chris Noxon, went to in November, Memphis, Tennessee, and he went to the Lorraine Motel where Dr. King, whose birthday we celebrated a week ago, was shot and taken from us nearly 49 years ago. And he kind of broke down in tears, like, how far has this country come? What's happening now? Will we take steps backwards? A lot of people have questioned that. And then he looked at the faces that were in that museum, the dignity of the people who put their bodies and lives on the line to accomplish what we've accomplished, and just in their mugshots, how kind of peaceful and strong they looked. And then he saw the faces of who we were fighting against back then, Bull Connor and George Wallace. And the civil rights movement wasn't, Bull Connor's a racist. It was, everybody should be at the lunch counter. And nobody should be denied school. And there shouldn't be two fountains. Keep your eye on standing up for what we want to see, not who's pissing us off. And that goes both directions. We saw it happen from Republicans to President Obama, and we see it happening with, you know, Democrats to President Trump. And I don't want to say all things are equal, but I think the mistake is to personalize this and make this about one person. That's a pretty powerless position to act from. Yelling is a pretty powerless thing to do. But actually marching and organizing and then doing, that's the most power that we have. And that's what we're called to do by this moment in history. Thank you.
Okay, the leadership here wants everybody out of here in the next 5 minutes, I think, or two. I just wanted to add one thing. First time I heard you talk, absolutely phenomenal. So thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you for being a friend of the Pacific Council. Thank you what you're doing for the film industry and for everything else in town. Good luck with the Olympics. When you mentioned being 13 at the Olympics, I was at the old Olympics, and all of a sudden I realized in 84 how old I'm getting. I'm jealous. Good luck with it. Thanks a million.